Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm certainly looking forward to today. It's wonderful to see everyone here today. Let's begin with a peace. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Excellent. Now, we've some housekeeping things. We've moved the announcements, because they also exist on the back page, we've moved them to up first in the service, so that we're able to get the business out of the way and then concentrate in the presence of the Spirit. So that'd be awesome. So are there any announcements from our faith community this morning that has to be said? Awesome. Okay. Face masks or coverage are now, they're now optional, but we encourage that you wear them if it makes you more comfortable. And if you're not feeling well, we hope you'll consider staying home. And we'll make sure that you are communicated with as to what happened during the service if you can't get onto YouTube to see a video of the live streaming. So starting today, we will have a few blessed prayer shawls available here in the sanctuary. They're so beautiful, and it takes a lot of work to do, but it is a blessing for those who make them and those who receive them. And if you wish to obtain one to give to someone who needs your prayers, you could take one. There are certainly more of those to choose from in the church office. It's just an awesome supply of them. And you can get them anytime during the weekday mornings. So please see a member of the Prayer Shawl Ministry, Diane Fitzpatrick, Bobby Pelletier, Colleen Harmon, to get one, okay? Now, we will have coffee fellowship, and we know that as far as the United Methodist denomination is concerned, coffee fellowship is one of the most important things we could do. So praise be to God, we're back together for that. Now, we're going to start something new starting next week, and that's the mystery box. It's very close to what, I guess, Tim had done with the bag. And it's a box every week. We're trying to get one the right size. And we're going to have them decorated by those blessed kids up in the sound booth. So they're all excited about it. Now, here's the thing. It's not Stump the Chump. I told you I would say that. What it is I'm going to ask someone different every week to take the box home and choose an item that's either special to them or something that is interesting. And at some point, I'll tell you the weird things that we had in the mystery box. But it was still successful, even during the pandemic when we were online. And for 3 minutes, I will connect whatever it is you put into the box with the theme of that day's worship or with Jesus and the gospel. And if the children are present at the time, they're going to come up and help me with doing that. Okay, so looking forward to that. All right. And finally, we will at some point in the near future, once we're out of boxes and we have internet again and television again, we will try to put together a men's gospel group. And we would probably call the gospel group Means of Grace, which is definitely a United Methodist phrase that means those things that we use in order to witness the love of Jesus Christ. And certainly, this congregation is full of the means of grace. I have anointing oil up here at the altar. And that means that both prayer shawls and the anointing oil are being blessed each and every time we're in the worship together. And during the service, before the Lord's Prayer, I believe, I'm going to ask if you're troubled, if you're ill in any way, just burdened in any way, there'll be an opportunity to come forward and actually be anointed. And that anointment is the oldest form of Christ's blessing that exists. So, with that all being said, if there are no other announcements, Then let us stand for our call to worship.
The world cries to us in its distress. How shall we answer?
We cannot pass by as though nothing is wrong.
How shall we answer?
We cannot become so focused on ourselves that others mean nothing to us.
How shall we answer?
We shall be the neighbor in service, reconciliation, and compassion wherever we can. In Jesus Christ, amen.
Our opening hymn is found in the Faith We Sing hymnal, and it is number 2086, Open Our Eyes.
We'll do this in unison, our opening prayer. Lord of justice and mercy, your presence, your compassion, clear our hearts of those things which block your will. Keep us focused on your enabling power so that we, having been healed, may more fully serve you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please be seated. Now let us take a moment to be in the spirit of prayer as we approach the face of Jesus Christ in our own personal prayer of confession. Lord, as we bring our personal confessions to a close, we are indeed blessed, Lord, to have you as our Savior. We are indeed blessed, Lord, to be able to come to you at any time, in any place, and just have a conversation. For, Lord, you know all about us. You know how many hairs we have upon our heads, and you knew our names before we were even born. So, Lord, thank you for allowing us to come to you and offer what we might have done wrong and strive to live a life as accord to your life, Lord. Brothers and sisters, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning. Our first lesson this morning comes from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 30, verses 9 through 14. Hear now these words. And the Lord your God will make you abundantly prosperous in all your undertakings, in the fruit of your body, in the fruit of your livestock, and in the fruit of your soil. For the Lord will again take delight in prospering you, just as he delighted in prospering your ancestors. When you obey the Lord your God by observing his commandments and decrees that are written in this book of the law, because you turn to the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Surely this commandment that I am commanding you today is not too hard for you, that you should say, who will go up to heaven for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it? Neither is it beyond the sea that you should say, who will cross to the other side of the sea for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it? No, the word is very near to you. It is in your mouth and in your heart for you to observe.
You know, there was a time in history where every different denomination together were killing themselves over what it is that they believe. And in an attempt in a Christian way to get together and acknowledge those things we do believe, creeds were developed so that we can, as various denominations, say this is what we all believe. So please turn to your hymnals 882. I need to get a hymnal. Thank you. Now I know what to do to prepare for next week. Please read with me the Apostles' Creed, Ecumenical Version. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the commitment of the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please stand as you are able for the gospel lesson this morning. Our gospel lesson is a very familiar story taken from the book of Luke, chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, what is written in the law? What do you read there? He answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you have given the right answer. Do this and you will live. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" And he said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
Weak and wounded sinner, lost and left to die. Or raise your head, for love is passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted and carried far away, and precious blood has washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. And like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember, when you walk, sometimes we fall. So fall on Jesus, fall on Jesus, and live. Sometimes the way is lonely and steeped and filled with pain. So if your sky is dark and pours the rain, then cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Oh, and when the love spills over and music fills the night, and when you can't contain the joy inside, then dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus. And live with your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, then go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus. Fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, and live. fly to Jesus. Fly to Jesus. Fly to Jesus and live. Saints, as you get to hear me preach, I'll say a little bit of what one of our previous bishops, Peter Weaver, had said. That when you get to know me, you'll know me as just a normal local pastor who loves the local church. And I talk with a Boston accent. I drop my R's, praise be to God. Diversity can be a good thing. You know, I came here this morning in the midst of a chaotic world, amidst division, violence, disunity, feelings of entitlement, poverty, disparity, pandemic effects, fears for our own future, our children's future, and the world's future. I am here to tell you that the Lord has never left you and that he will never leave us. Praise be to God. And to give us direction to reach that eternal life in Christ's great commandment, the golden rule of life from Leviticus, the third sacred book of the Torah, chapter 19, verse 18, do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against anyone among your people, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. And even this passage from Leviticus, the foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself, for you were foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord, your God. John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, wrote, "Even today, God the Father, Jesus the Son, and God's Holy Spirit are actively in the world, working together to bring about your salvation." Do you believe that?
Yes.
Okay, I'm a little hard of hearing up here. And I'll tell you why. The whole world seems to move, motivated by the worries and the concerns and the burdens in their lives, their health, health of the family. Well, how are we going to make it? And people are so concerned about that, they forget that God is with them. How awesome is that? That the person who created you, his son, is aware of you and cares about you. There is nothing you can't do if you do it with God. Brothers and sisters, it sounds like each of us inspects our personal glossary of terms and makes sure we have clarity around what it is to be a neighbor. I mean, I remember the days as a kid that I used to know my neighbor's name. We'd all play together or something like that, you know, and even a neighbor would knock on the door on a Sunday morning and said, "Listen, could you take Rich and Robert? I have a twin. Can you take Richard and Robert to church? I have to do an errand. I'll be there and meet you a little later." You see, we cared for one another. We knew who neighbors were. And with electronics and politics and cable television and everything, the world is becoming smaller. And even though it's becoming smaller, we know less people. So how do you recognize when your neighbor is in trouble and needs our help in some way. It's not easy oftentimes to be sensitive of others. I mean, our own personal loss, our lives are so full. We have our own personal agendas. We have other things we have to do, responsibilities at home. How many of you have had to raise children or are raising children? Whew. Now that was just a walk in the park, right? They didn't put up any stink at all with your directions, did they? And they always said, yes, Mom, yes, Dad, you know best. All right? We have other things we have to do, responsibilities, as I said, even caring for family members with problems or as we get older, the health that we have to contend with. And we may even forget that we don't help our children and grandchildren if we don't help our grandchildren know about God and Christ. They too will need the help of a good Samaritan someday. And especially in this crazy world where they're growing up into. And I am indeed thankful and joyous to see some kids among us. And listen, if you ever want to bring a family member, a younger family member in, you know, and they're making noise in church, a blessed noise. A blessed noise. So let me ask you, saints, aren't our family members, those we love and those who worship right beside us, are they not our neighbors also? For that's the key, isn't it? Try as I might, I always seem somewhere along the line to slip up and not be aware of someone's need. How about you? I mean, oftentimes people have to come up, and I encourage people coming up to me and saying, Pastor, I'm aware that someone is in need. God has placed it on your heart, and you've communicated it. There's no reason why we cannot address it. For the Lord, as the kids say, has taken us to it. The Lord will get us through it. To be honest, I've often been so involved with my own calendar that I might be aware of a problem, but cannot bring myself to deal with it. How about you? Or I may be clueless, and I'm not saying I was doing it to be judgmental or uncaring. My plate gets so full. And there's so much to do. Do you know what I mean? It's just that my radar was not up. I wish, and I've said this behind every pulpit, I wish that there was a radio you could turn on up here in Caribou, WGOD. And you turn it on and it says, Rich, here's what you have to do today. Here's who you'll meet today. Instead, our radar tells us, as we develop our relationship with Jesus Christ, that radar tells us that person needs to hear something that's hopeful. I have the authority or the power, as having heard it, to reach out somehow. In Luke 10, 25 to 37, Jesus presents this parable after a lawyer tries to test Jesus in the beginning of verse 25, by asking how we can inherit eternal life. The lawyer knows that to inherit eternal life, the law states, amongst other things, to love your neighbor. So, of course, he asks, what is your neighbor? Who is my neighbor? Do you know, saints, who your neighbor is? Do you even know the needs, the concerns, and the troubles of the person in the pew in front of you? Now, you don't have anyone in the pew in front of you, but that doesn't absolve you of any responsibility. You know, Jesus replies with a parable which begins with a man who was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. And this man, of course, was a Jew. During his journey, he's robbed and beaten by thieves. Now, a priest who sees the disheveled man by the side of the road, continues on his way without helping him. Now, in the Hebrew culture at the time, if someone touched such a person, someone who's bleeding, disheveled, in trouble, they would be rendered ceremoniously unclean, and the priest would not be able to go to temple and be able to even worship with a congregation or lead a congregation. So he probably just left the man to die by the side of the road. After all, he had important work to do. Surely someone else would come along to offer help. Now another man passes by, a Levite, but he also refuses to stop and check on the beaten man. Perhaps the Levite, also working at the temple, keeper of the sacred Torah for the temple, maybe he also would be rendered unclean also if he touched that man. So he perhaps thought it was wiser to consider his job more important than that man's life. Surely someone else would come along to help in this situation, but not today. Finally, a Samaritan sees the man. Rather than passing by like the predecessors, the Samaritan stops and cares for the man. He pours wine and oil on his wounds, bandages him, places him on his own animal. Now that means that he's going to have to walk all the way to town because this person who's damaged is on his animal. He takes him to an inn to care for him there. The next day, the Samaritan gives the innkeeper 2 denarii, enough currency to provide the cost of lodging. And the parable finishes with the Samaritan leaving the battered man in the inn, but with plans in returning and paying an extra fee, anything that would accumulate while he is gone. I'm wondering who today would do that. What is shocking about this parable is that Jesus uses the Samaritan as the individual to help the man. And the Samaritans were considered evil, dirty. They were the ones who intermarried and sort of broke the traditional heritage and lineage of a pure Hebrew family. Brothers and sisters, how can our church be a place where we show the passionate, tenacious love of God for humanity, not for just a United Methodist Church in Caribou, Maine? How can we reach across ethnic and cultural lifestyle boundaries to show that God shows mercy and compassion to anyone in need? How can we make sure that our attempts to loving our neighbor are not just ways to justify ourselves and show off our righteousness? How can we move from doing just acts of compassion, checking off things on our list, to actually being compassionate people who can't help but overflow with the love of Christ? How can we ensure that we're not offering excuses as we pass by those who need our help the most? This has been a question and a challenge for centuries. American pastor, theologian, and Christian apologist Timothy Keller, author of Generous Justice, wrote, "We instinctively tend to limit for whom we exert ourselves. We do it for people like us and for people whom we like." Jesus says we cannot do that. By depicting a Samaritan helping a Jew, Jesus could not have found a more forceful way to say that anyone at all in need, regardless of race, politics, class, and religion, is your neighbor. Not everyone is your brother or sister in faith, but everyone is your neighbor. Martin Luther King says on the parable of Good Samaritan, I imagine that the first question the priest and Levite asks was, if I stop to help this man, what will happen to me? Have you ever hesitated helping someone because you did not know either the whole story or even understand how that affects you? But by the very nature, King says, of his concern, the Good Samaritan reversed the question. If you do not stop to help this man, what will happen to him? And that's a missing part of the puzzle when we go out and about in a normal day and we're faced with things and the Holy Spirit brings us to people and places that need help. If I don't do it, what will happen to the person who's asked for help? What would happen to the church? What would happen in the community? Brothers and sisters, we've got to pay attention to our surroundings and be aware of God. As King had said, it's our circle of awareness. If it's only on ourselves, we don't immediately consider our eternal. We often look at troubles around us affecting our friends and families because when we do this and we help them, it often affects us positively as well. But we need to, for the sake of our souls and the sake of the growing faith, to ask the difficult question, if I don't do it, who else will? What will happen to that person, church member, even that committee? And I'm not saying it just for this church, I'm saying that every single church I've been at, because the problem exists everywhere. Churches are getting smaller, there's less people able to perform functions. And Bertrand Russell, one of the 20th century's most noted philosophers, wrote, if you wish to understand this parable the way it was heard when Jesus spoke it, replace the word Samaritan in this parable with words like Germans and Japanese, North Korea, China, Russia, for example. He continues, I fear my modern-day Christians would resent such a substitution because it would compel us to realize just how far we have strayed from Christ's teaching. The message of the parable of the Good Samaritan is as relevant today as it was more than 2,000 years ago. So we're called to help those in trouble, even if the person we help is someone we do not like. How many times have you worked with someone in a workplace or in your family that you just, for some reason, didn't get along with or you didn't deal with something? God has a sense of humor. And dollars to donuts, that's an old saying. Some of you might understand what that means. Dollars to donuts, the Lord will take you to the same kind of person in the same situation until you learn the lesson God has planned for you. So conflict, mistrust, and hate still exist today between groups of people. We still see prejudices in segregated neighborhoods. People still disassociate with others based on all sorts of righteous criteria. This challenge was no easier for those who heard Jesus speak the words than it is for us today. And it seems to be an impossible task. So saints, remember that God's with you. And remember that the God, I said this last week, I think, that the God who was able to have the power to raise Jesus Christ from the dead to life certainly has the power to change your life. So don't be thinking that you're either not good enough or your problem is too big for God or your illness is something that you need to ignore or even stress overly about. You need to engage with Jesus Christ, the power that resides in you to help transform your life. Remember that with God, all things are possible. Amen. Now, Bobby, I'm not supposed to have a list of the people who we've been praying for? have the one. Oh.
We tried to hide it.
Wow. Okay, thank you. I'll get it. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we care for one another. We are all children of God. We ask your blessings, Lord, upon Jeanette Peters, Debbie and Lou Sharp, Gary and Marilyn Langley, Ivan Shaw, Audrey Bubar, Leland Frost, Richard and Susan Clark, Warren Dobson, Colleen Harmon, Ralph and Gwen Ferguson, Connie Collins, Bob White, Richard Card, Sylvia Ickley, Bob Locke, Jason Giggy, Roger Bossi. Lord, we ask for these saints that you touch them with your Holy Spirit. And we ask, Lord, if they are in waiting for procedures, Lord, we ask that you go before them in all things with all the doctors and nurses in whose care they have been placed. Let them feel your holy presence and your healing touch. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now, saints, is there anyone here who wants to mention in real time the need of prayer? Anyone? Yes, sir. Anyone else? Okay. Lord, we ask your blessings upon all those who are and blessings for safety of all those who are involved in the Ukrainian war, Lord. There are casualties, Lord, on both sides. There are families that hurt on both sides. There are countries and communities drawn into this. So, Lord, we don't know the answer. But we do know we worship a risen Savior. So, Lord, we ask for your involvement. We ask for your settling of this situation in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Now, I've mentioned a little while ago about anointing. Does anyone feel the need to be anointed today? Please come up. Please join me in our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Now we come to the time of the service with our tithes and offerings. And we have that to present. Oh, Heavenly Father, we raise this offering to you. Please accept this humble offering. We know, Lord, that our life is in service to you, and all the resources we have, Lord, we have because of your love for us. Lord, give us clarity around the gifts that we possess, Lord. And may this offering be in the hands of those who can bring your kingdom closer. Lord, help us as your holy servants to be in this place and out into the community, evangelizing your presence among us. And may this offering go to fulfill the needs within this body of Christ and in this community. Lord, we ask all this in your holy, precious name. Amen. Please open our hymnals to hymn 413, For a Charge to Keep I Have.
Outside this door, you walk on holy ground. And you walk on holy ground because Jesus Christ is your partner in your holy work. And you share the same Holy Father. So may our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, when you leave, be with you. So that means don't be cowering. Don't be doubtful. Don't leave knowing that you are filled with the Holy Spirit that is a direct conduit to your Creator. So how awesome is that? That there's no problem that you can face that God can't help you fix. Because God needs you to be where you need to be. Grow, saints, where you are planted. You have the power, believe it or not, to transform your life and those around you just because of your faith. So don't ignore people who are in need. God will give you what you need to get in touch with those people who can help. But you need to communicate. All right. That's a sermon for another day. May our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ bless you and keep you. May he make his countenance.